Well, whatever, sure. They always benefit from a team. I've just ordered that. I'd actually gone into town to do a job this morning for someone. And I knew it wouldn't take me too long, it only took me about 40 odd minutes. Which is about right. I thought I'll go to Aldi, and I wasn't feeling too brilliant, I'll be honest. Right, let's have a look at you. Find out what you are. That looks like a very thing. Very thin piece of metal. I would say that has had an issue with a pickup point. But yeah, sometimes you can't get what you want in a small town. You see, a bigger town, I would have said even like Boston, but Boston's just about gone downhill now. But a bigger town, let's say like Grimsby, what I wanted today, which was another set of helping hands, there would have been two stores that I know of straight away without even having to get Google out that would have probably had them. Whereas in Skegness there is, well, normally there's one shop that normally has them. I think this is happening a lot of the smaller towns, that everything is going outside. It's going to sort of like big out of town shopping centres. Things like that, and I think it's going to end up killing a lot of the small shops. And I think the one I went into today, up until a few years, well, probably up until just before COVID, I would always go for a walk around town at some point, especially at Christmas, because I always believed in having a walk around town to see what I could find for Christmas presents. Well, I've actually got that running. And now, obviously COVID hit and everybody had to shut down, and unless you were a food shop or a DIY shop, you couldn't open. So a lot of the places went online, which, like I said, I have, you know, people have to earn a living. Now, because everybody was ordering everything on eBay, Amazon, and things like that, it's harder now for a lot of these little shops to recover. And I think that is what's going to happen. I think this is why so many little model shops packed up. It was because although they were successful, I remember the one that was down the high street in Stead, there was always people in it. But I think the reason why it became not less, I think broke what to retire, and the new owners, they just didn't really know how to operate it. Let's take a bit of this off here. I do have black wire, it's just I had a bit of green in it. That's better, that's good. Yeah, I think that's why a lot of your, well, I think a lot of your model shops have all, I won't say packed up, but a lot of your little independent shops, the only way they've survived is by literally doing what everybody else is doing, and that is going online. And to be fair, yes, you're now in a time, relative dimension of space. Gold coffee. That if you don't advertise online, then you're going to lose out. Because there isn't the yellow pages anymore that there used to be. You know, so if you want somebody to find you, the only way they are actually going to find you is by the internet, because like I said, there is no more yellow pages, there is no more, you know, telephone directories and things like that. Made me jump, I knew it was coming. This is where your helping hand come in handy, because now you've got two bits of wire you need to twist together. one of them's a small piece, and
yeah,
I know people can do it without the helping hands. I just end up really burning myself. You're about to find out. But I must admit, I bought this kit, this soldering station. Purely for Mother Railway, because it is variable temp. You can actually lower it right down to about 10 volts or 10 watts or right back up to like 50. Like I said, I find it's pretty good for doing this sort of stuff. I do miss having the heat shrink to hand. Never mind. Like Jenna was saying the other day, you don't want to just drip your solder onto it. You want to put, that's why you tin both wires, and then you can just keep the heat on and just leave it for 30 seconds or so. And this little gizmo here is just a soldering brush cleaner, soldering iron cleaner, and it just takes the crap off of the nib. I mean, you can just re-tin it. I do like soldering. I do like the smell of it. Bummer. All the time I've been using this, and I thought it would be resin cord. I suppose I should have been using a flux. Oh well, never mind. So this is where the likes of your helping hands come in handy. There's a weight here, weren't there? Where did I put that one? There. Now, I feel it should be mentioned, because you're bound to see. I'll let that cool down for a minute. Bound to see me take out things like this out of Lamco's. And you're going to think, what the hell are they? Are they some sort of motor or a top, but nothing but a big lump of steel. Okay. And these will be like, these are cold milled steels. They come out of the smelting factory. They roll down to a certain diameter, and you can buy these off of the shelf. You can't quite get them at like DIY stores. You have to normally send off for them. But anyway, and these are so that the locomotive has actually got some weight, so it will actually stay on the track. Whereas if you have a loco that is very, very light, the moment it goes round a corner, at any speed, it's just going to fly off. And also, the moment it sort of decides that it's reached a bit of a hill, again, it's just not going to have any weight to help give it any traction. Some locos are different, but they all require weight. Some will. Oh, pardon me. Oh dear.